Howdy, my name is Sean Krieger. I am doing this video to showcase my shipping container duplex investment. If you're watching this video, I hope by the end of it you go, wow, every single question has been answered. If you're looking at the bottom and you're thinking, man, this is a long video, I'm not sure if I have enough time, let me just cut it short. We make over 12% return on investment on every single one of these that we do. It is the lowest possible risk that you could imagine. And it's a tangible asset. It's an absolutely phenomenal investment. Now, before I start talking about the container aspect at large, I want to talk to you about the market. I want you to really understand on a macro level what's happening in the market to understand why this container home is the best possible investment for you. I'm also going to stack it up against other investments and show you why, you might be able to make more money with those, but you just might not. It's really exciting, really interesting. Let's dive right on into it. So I'm just in whiteboard. I'm going to be drawing a bunch of stuff. So there's two graphs here that I want to show you. One is the Treasury note. The other is LIBOR, the London Interbank Offer Rate. So these are the interest rates that you would expect in society. This top graph is LIBOR, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months. And so what you're going to see is in 1990, LIBOR was a little bit over 8%. By the time you come down to 2010, it's like 1%, might even be under 1%, which is insanity. The interest rate today is lower than it has ever been, probably in the entire history of the world. It's an insanely low interest rate, and it has so many implications to the market at large. You're seeing the exact same thing here. This is the Treasury bill. This is what the United States pays in interest, and you're looking at it now, a 30-year Treasury bill is just over 2%. It's crazy. It's crazy that interest could be so low. Some of this barely even fights inflation. So the second thing I want to show you is the actual median household income, both nominal and real. There's a reason I'm showing you this. If you adjust it for inflation since 2000, I'm zooming in on this graph, the number hasn't really changed very much. You've got a very, very marginal increase in a span of about 20 years, and people aren't earning as much as they used to on the middle and bottom. And this is a large portion of our market. I mean, remember, that's 50% of people are not earning as much. Now, the top's doing great, and that's why you're hearing Bernie Sanders over and over, oh my gosh, the earnings and wages and blah, blah, blah. There's a lot to it, and you can see it literally from this graph. The red line is what the wages did, but the blue is it's adjusted for inflation, and this is the one you should look at. In 2000, if you came all the way to 2012, people had lost $5,000 a year in income. I mean, that's pretty bad. Here's even more interesting. So we're seeing right here that wages aren't really going up, but we are getting far more debt for the exact same people. So they're not making any more money, but they're far more in debt, whether it's revolving debt, non-revolving debt, could be student loans, could be house loans, could be all kinds of loans. But consumer debt is on the rise right now. So we're lending money, and I'm backing it up here so that you can see it coming through. The interest rate's lower, so we're lending more money to people who are not earning more and expecting them to pay it back. This isn't a recipe for success. It's not something that I look at in the market and think, oh, wow, this is great. This is really going to be helpful. Let me continue here. So I'm going to show you a couple more things here. So we have the home price index here, which is this bottom one in the blue. You're going to see that home prices have been on the rise since 1980. This is adjusted for inflation. So the house that you're living in now costs more than it did in 1980, and it's substantially more. The graph above it is one from the National Association of Home Builders, and this is the cost of regulation in the average house. One thing I'm going to stress here is the average house is now, I think they had it at over $300,000. So the average house that they're considering here is very, very expensive. And you can see here, they've got $66,000 in regulatory costs in 2011. And in 2016, that number has gone up. Some of this is adjusted for inflation as well. But I can tell you, over this 5 year period, the regulatory costs in construction has gone up 30%. It's crazy. It's crazy. 30%. I want people to remember that. The cost to build is skyrocketing. And you can see it here as well. This is a composite price index of all properties. And you can see in 2000, it's that's their baseline. It's here. Do 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 do. It goes up and then it crashes in 08 because that's what happened. But look where it's at right now. Look where it's at. Investing in apartments. This is the price index. Now I want you to understand, looking at a large scale, okay, why is the price index going like this? Well, number one, I can tell you this much. The National Association of Home Builders says that 30% of all multifamily costs, that's this red line right here, is regulatory. And it's going up and it's increasing over a 5-year span, which is about where this is. I mean, this is even more than 5 years, but you can see it. If the cost goes up 30%, this thing goes to here just from the regulatory costs. It's this huge portion of this graph. And so regulation is massively, massively driving up the cost to construct things, and it's making everything more expensive. And there's your price index here that makes it more expensive. But there's another thing that's going on, and that's this interest rate. And I'm going to do a little math here so that you guys can see. So when this interest rate drops, it increases the value of the portfolio fairly substantially. So if you have, and I'm going to start drawing here for you, if you have an 80-20 loan to value, 80% loan to value, then that means that every 1% increase in interest rate, which is this 80, decreases your returns by 4%, because this 80-20 relationship goes, and 80 is 4 times 20. So if your note goes up, if this interest rate here, which is at 2%, if that goes to 6% on an 80% loan to value, that's 2%. This is times 2, so you've lost 8% on your returns. So let's imagine that you're in the market, and the average market should be at 5%, but it is actually right now at 2.5%. You've lost 10%, or you've gained 10% because it's cheaper right now, because that interest rate goes down. So your asset is worth more. So your $100,000 house, apartment, unit, whatever you're using, I'm making the numbers easy, is now worth $110,000, and the numbers will go up to try and match these cap rates because the interest rate is so low. Now, as you can imagine, hopefully you're figuring this out, they did this on purpose. This is 2008. The crash happens. So real estate is just going downhill super fast. Everything's going bad. So what they did was they said, oh, we'll drop the interest rate to zero. And when we do that, there's more cash in the market. When there's more cash in the market, prices go up. And so one of the things that you can see is that because there's a plethora of cash in the market, all of the price of everything is going up. It's easily explained. All these graphs just showed you what was happening here. Now, I want you to think about something for a second. We're talking about finances. We're talking about portfolios, and we're talking about loan to value, and we're talking about making money this way. Has the asset on the ground changed? Is the apartment complex any different? Is the thing that you're building any different? No, it's the exact same thing. In fact, it could be an existing apartment complex. Once you do this over here to the interest rate, that existing apartment complex goes from being worth 10 million to 12 or 14, or God knows whatever it is based on your loan to value and everything. And that's exactly what happened, and that's how they try to stabilize the market. But just like every other governmental policy, we're getting pretty greedy. It should have gone up here. You can see it. It started to go up. Trump took office and he said, no, we're not going to let this go up. We're going to take it down. And guess what the markets did? They responded because the stock market recognizes and goes, oh, well, the underlying asset is worth more because I'm making more cash because I'm not paying this interest rate here. There's one more thing that I want to discuss here when we're talking about interest rates and the apartment portfolios and all that. The next thing to discuss is that this is assuming this 80-20 loan to value. So I'm moving it here. What if it were 90-10? What if you got riskier? Right? Now, instead of being 4 to 1, right? Now you're 9 to 1. So if this interest rate goes up 2%, which I had, kind of down here, you've lost 18% of the equity that you're creating, of your return on investment. That 18% right there accounts for a huge portion of the asset value. So your $10 million apartment complex where you're singing might drop to $8 million and you've just lost, because you only had 10% in there. You've just lost more money than you even have in the deal, and the bank's going to be pissed at you, and you know the market's going to collapse. That's what's going to happen. All the assets are going to devalue once this interest rate comes up, because if it comes back to where I'm pointing up here, look at that graph, if it comes back to there, all those people with those apartment portfolios, whenever they have to go and refinance, they're not going to be able to. They don't have enough money in the deal. It's not making enough money, and it's not worth anything. Because remember, when you're valuing the asset at the interest rate that's lower, it's worth a lot more than it is when the interest rate is higher. And it has absolutely nothing to do with you as the apartment owner, as the person who's created this portfolio, who's the finance guy who's underwriting this deal. It has nothing to do with you. It's a macro level thing when it comes to the economy. Now, why am I telling you this? Why is this so important? Well, my deal is not based on this market interest rate. I mean, there are factors at play here, and I still have to work within the confines of this market, but my deal is so much different. I'm not portfolioing an apartment complex and figuring out a way to finance it at 90-10 at a lower interest rate than everybody else, and therefore I've made value. That's not what I'm doing. I'm actually building something. So let me talk about building something here. So I knew all of this stuff going into it. I knew the interest rates. I knew the consumer index. I knew all of these. Let me touch on the consumer index real fast. The under $200,000 market, the year that I started, was up, I think it was 12 to 14%. I can't remember where it was, but it's around that number. So if there was a home that was selling for $200,000, there were 12% more buyers on the market than the year before. Seriously, if you can sell a home for under $200,000 and you're not in a crackhead neighborhood, it's going to sell almost immediately. And it still will today. I know people who are making great money doing this, but you know what happened to them? This regulatory cost happened. Now the regulatory costs are so high that you can't make any money, because remember, right here, they're considering that this is $83,000 in regulatory costs on a $300,000 home. Think about that for a second. What if it was a $200,000 home and there's $83,000 in regulatory costs? Now your regulatory costs like half the stinking home. And that's what the market is right now. And nobody wants to say it, but you know what? I live in Houston, so I understand what's happening at the city. They're trying to regulate things more because, number one, Democrats and the people who are in charge don't view it as regulation. They view it as safety. Oh my God, the free market is going to create a home that's going to collapse and blah, 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 blah. And we can talk about that for hours. But then the second thing that happens is they're getting revenue off of it. So they're selling these permit fees. These costs right here, they're making a dime on every single transaction that they do. And the Houston Permitting Center last year, I think 2 years ago actually was when I looked at it, made $24 million for the city. This is a city that's going bankrupt. You think they're going to cut back on this $24 million cash cow? Absolutely not. So this market, this affordable housing market, this one right here that services the bulk of people, over half of the people in the United States, and I'm just crappily drawing this here, it's dried up. You can't build it anymore. So I looked at that, and I had one thought in mind. If I can build a house that's cheaper than everyone else on a price, then I can service this market, and I will consistently be able to beat the market average regardless of this interest rate, regardless of all these other things, because I'm actually delivering a product to the market that's usable. Because forget about all that portfolio theory. Forget about all that stuff. That stuff is not important. The underlying idea is important. You need a house, you need a place to live, and somebody has to provide it. And so if you can provide it at a better price than everyone else, then you've won. You've won the game. You will always consistently be able to beat the market and have a stable asset. Now, I didn't just happen upon containers. I researched it for months. I mean, I literally spent every single night researching how to build something cheaper than everyone else. And I did it consistently over and over and over. So I came to containers. Most people, when they do containers, they're looking for a super nice, fancy house. Not me. I looked at containers, and this is real numbers. I bought them for $1,600 a container. The first one I did 5 years ago, and today, the price of containers, I just got a quote, not $1,200, I just got a quote for $1,350 a container. So the price of containers has dropped, and I can tell you why. We have a trade disparity. So regardless of Trump's antics with China, when we ship stuff out, we ship it out in a 20-foot container that holds 55,000 pounds, and we're sending wellheads, we're sending heavy machinery and difficult stuff to manufacture that China can't make themselves. And in return, China is sending us the widgets that we don't want to make because it's not worth our time. They're just small, they're imprecise, and you know what? They fit in 40-foot containers that hold 60,000 pounds. You see the difference? They hold about the same amount of weight, but you can fill a 40-footer with twice as much stuff if it's light and fluffy stuff. And that's exactly what happens. And this price went down because right now in Houston, the last number I looked at, there are 120,000 containers sitting on the ground in Houston. 40-foot high cube containers that I use in construction. Now, consider this as well. I know that the price of containers is going to be stable, and in fact, relatively, is probably going to go down over the next 5 years, where every other kind of building material, the price generally goes up. So if you're using lumber, you're still beholden to the market, and it might go up. But here's the beauty of containers, and here's the beauty of my homes. I didn't just look at the container portion and say, well, this is cheaper, so that's what I'm going to do. I looked at it holistically, and I said, how can I save my 10 cents everywhere I go through this build? Because at the end of it, it's 20 to 30% is the number that I have that's lower. So I have the containers, they're metal, they're waterproof, they hold more weight than anything else on the market. This max stack weight is like 900,000 pounds. These things can hold a tremendous amount of weight. I put it on a pier and beam foundation. All those homes that you're looking at from the 70s and 80s with the cracked slabs, that's because they're on a slab and we're in expansive soil. And so I knew that pier and beam was better for expansive soil than a slab. And let me tell you, there's a number of people in Houston who built container homes on slabs. Seriously, I'm not kidding. I've worked on one in the Fifth Ward. It's there. I can show it to you. So these are people that aren't really considering what the best possible scenario is. They're just kind of rinse and repeat, build the same thing over and over. Ooh, containers, cool. I'll add those in. That's not me. I spanned them so that I could put a front and back wall on so I could have a nice living room space so it didn't feel so cramped. I put trusses over top because the roof was cheaper to do with trusses than to do any other way. And trust me, I looked at every other way you can possibly imagine. I went through this build to create the absolute most efficient HVAC system. And then I improved it and improved it again. And I'm constantly sitting around and improving it. And so what you're getting as an end product is not just this metric. It's not just that it's cheaper, but it's a better product. It has a better foundation. It has better structural supports. It's got a roof with a 20-year warranty. It's got the best possible HVAC system that I can muster for the price that it has with the least linear feet of ducts so that the compressor doesn't blow out. I thought about all these different things. I've chatted with engineers about all of them. I've done my absolute best. Now here's where the proof is really in the pudding. So I know I can build this thing right here, and I know that it makes money. So where do I put it? Okay, all else equal, if you can beat construction costs, what you want to do is you want to get your land cost to zero. Because if you could imagine, if I have a house that I'm building and half the cost is land, and I'm going to draw this out for you. I want to use the whiteboard so I don't get boring here. If 50-50 land and asset, right? If I drop 20% here, if I can make the actual cost to build 20% less over here on the asset side, then I've only dropped the total by 10% because land is half of it. You see? But if the land costs zero, which is what I'm looking for, I go to junk neighborhoods, I get the cheapest possible lot I can, and I get the land down to zero, then this 10% over here rises back up and it gets to the 20% that I'm looking for. That's the proof that's in the pudding. That's why I go into the crappiest neighborhoods possible. I mean, this year I really did a feat. This was the first time I ever built a house that didn't have a murder on the street while I was building it. Woohoo! I've accomplished greatness here in this past year. Things are really looking up. Maybe Sylvester Turner, the mayor of Houston's right. Maybe crime is going down. Who knows? Right? But here we are. So I'm going into these poor neighborhoods. I'm getting land as cheap as I possibly can. I'm building this thing under the market price. And this is the most beautiful part of my whole investment. I know that the average person is going to pay a certain amount on rent. We know this number, we know the average rental prices, but the better part is I'm utilizing a government program called Section 8. They've actually changed the name to, I think it's Houston Housing Voucher. They don't like calling it, you know, the Third Ward. They don't like calling it Section 8. They don't like those kind of cold names. You know, they're trying to make it sound a lot sexier than it is. But basically, it's a government program that says, if you build something, or if you have this place that's for rent, we will give this voucher to a tenant, and we will have a preset number, and that's our rental price, and we will pay it as the government, and the tenant doesn't owe us anything. Doesn't owe you anything, doesn't owe us anything, we'll pay it. And they pay it with a direct deposit. And that direct deposit hits my bank account every single month, as long as there's a tenant in here. Now, if you know that rental price, and I know it, for the neighborhood that I build in, it's about $1,350 per month. So I know that that's my rental price. And I know what it costs to build. So if my cost to build was at the market rate, my returns would probably be maybe 6% ROI. If I'm really looking at it, I'm just kind of guessing. Because the cost of construction, and we talked about this over here, the cost of construction has gone so high that you can't make any money building affordable housing. And I didn't add this on the graph, 98% of all multifamily units in the United States are Class A properties. Because the only way that you can make money when your build cost is this high up here, the only way that you can make money on it is obviously if the rental price is enough. And this amount right here for Section 8 isn't enough to make good money on it. Unless I'm building for 20% less than everyone else. Because if I'm building for 20% less than everyone else, and you can imagine here, that means that I make 26% ROI. Woohoo! Now, there's a little bit to it, because some of the costs here, this is going to be lower, because some of the cost is like interest, and some of it is like GC costs, and so the time to GC it is about the same, so I still got to pay some of those, and you know, et cetera, et cetera. But the truth is, rather than making maybe 26%, and I just kind of spitballed this, and I just kind of spitballed the 20% lower, because there is land cost, so it's not 100%. I mean, I'm using the idea here that the land is zero, and it's not. My land ranges from 25,000, and I'm entertaining a lot right now for 41,000. And so this is actually about 25% of the deal, and it has nothing to do with the build cost. But take all those numbers into consideration, and I'm at an ROI of probably about 22%. Every time that I do the math and I run it through and I do all the calculators and I do the IRR and all these kind of fancy terms, that's what I'm getting to. Now, here's the gorgeous part about this, and I mentioned it. This housing voucher here, I run a company where I text message over 1,000 people per month, and I set them up and I find them housing as an apartment locator. So it takes me 3 weeks or less to fill a unit, and I've done it as fast as 3 days. So whenever I have a vacancy or I know a vacancy is coming up, I've already got another lease signed. So I have virtually no vacancy. I have a government program that is paying me every month, and I don't have to worry about it. And I have this construction project that I personally built that has all these other qualities to it. It's the best possible construction, and it's not just cheap, it's well made. I know how everything works. I know what's in the walls. I know what my maintenance is. And let me tell you this. I am assuming on this 22% here, standard maintenance, standard taxes, standard insurance. And this deal actually has better for all three of those within the deal. The taxes are lower. And you know why the taxes are lower? Because I go to the taxing authority and I tell them, hey, this is made out of containers. This is a piece of crap. I actually had a project that I did side by side with another gentleman. This guy remodeled a 1960s little bungalow home. It was on pier and beams. It's one of those crappy old homes. He remodeled it. The tax authority gave him a grade of B+ because he made the outside look nice, and they gave my house a grade of C-. Brand new construction. They were like, this sucks. And so that drops the value on the appraisal. So the taxes are lower, so I pay less than that. When you look at insurance, I tell them that I'm metal frame, because guess what? The house holds up as a metal frame. So my insurance is lower because it's also semi-inflammable, and people like that. They like that. So the last part is maintenance, and I've got metal walls. I've got a pier and beam foundation. Half my stuff is under warranty, and I'm going to write that. I've got a warranty on over half of the items in the house that might cause maintenance issues, and that's part of the build cost, and I know that is, so don't worry about it. It's covered. So you're going to be good on this thing for multiple years. I mean, you're talking 5 to 7 years, probably until you start seeing real maintenance issues, unless you're turning over units. But again, we've turned over a ton of units for very, very little money. I mean, this year alone on maintenance, I spent $120. $120 year one. That's it. The last duplex I did. I can tell you those numbers. I just paid the guy. I had one guy I was doing little stuff for, and I finally said, "Hey, here's $100. You know, $120. Here you go." And he was over the moon. So, when you look at it, this is all great. So now you're probably thinking, Sean, 22%. Everything looks good. The numbers look great. Wow. Oh my goodness. This is the greatest asset, you know, since sliced bread. Well, here's the real problem. This is what's killing me right here. This is the loan to value. So I go to a bank and I say, I have this container home and it nets $2,650 a month and I built it for $200,000. I'd like to refinance it, please. And they go, we don't lend on container homes. And I go, no, it's just a normal home. They go, no, we won't do it. So time and time and time again, banks don't want to lend. They definitely don't want to lend on the construction because you're renting to Section 8, and back up here so you can see it again. You're renting to Section 8 in this housing voucher program, and they don't understand it because no one is building new construction. Remember, the numbers don't work. I've shown you that the numbers don't work. I've shown you that the numbers should be marginal at best. You should barely be making any money on it. So no one is building Section 8 housing. The only people who are building straight to Section 8 housing in all of the United States, no matter where you are in the United States, doesn't matter where you are because we're all using the same building code, which is causing all these costs over here. The only people that are doing it are doing some kind of a government program. Maybe it's a tax incentive or you know, there's all kinds of different housing and community development programs, but they all come in the same way. The government's paying for it because 6% ain't going to fly. The government has to figure out a way to get that to 10% or higher, or nobody's going to bite on it. So the banks have never seen this development whatsoever. They've never done a straight build to Section 8 vouchers. They've never done it. I've talked to 100 banks in Houston. I don't know anyone that has experience doing what I'm doing. They just don't do it. There's only a few people in all of Houston that I know that do it, and most of them are using foreign money because it's a nice, easy safe haven. So they don't like the Section 8. They don't like the neighborhood. Remember, people are getting killed on the street while I'm doing this. I've had guys, you know, pull guns on me. I mean, welcome to the real world. This is fun. No, not really. But I have seen a serious amount of crime, and I have had somebody in a mask approach me on my job site. So, you know, this is no joke. I mean, these are real deal problems. So I've got that going. And so when you go to the bank and you say, "Hey, I'd like to do this loan," and you start talking the deal, okay, let's do. Well, you're never going to get this 90-10 split. Just cross that out. You're never going to get it because the bank isn't going to want to do it. So you might get this 80-20 loan to value, and they say, "Okay, look, well, let's send it out for an appraisal." Remember, there's no comps. So in this neighborhood, you know, I'm building it. There hasn't been a new duplex built in this neighborhood in 10 years. They just don't do it. And I want you to understand the duplex that was built 10 years ago was built and contracted. I know the price because I talked with the guy who built it for the same price that I contracted to build one of my duplexes 10 years later. The exact same price. And remember, the costs have substantially gone up. I've shown you this graph, so you know. I'm not making anything up. He said 151,000. I built a duplex the same year for 152,000. Totally marginal increase. So I'm hitting the numbers that he was hitting 10 years ago, and some of those houses went bankrupt. But don't worry too much. The Section 8 housing voucher program, it keeps going up in price. Normally, it's matching inflation around 2 to 3%. And what I think is going to happen with the program, I think it's going to go up even more because I think they're going to struggle to get people to accept Section 8. And when that happens, the market is going to push it up. And I've already seen it. There's been talks at housing and community development. I've talked to people who said, "Yeah, I think we need to increase it," and blah, 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 blah. But you're always going to have this standard increase in market rate rent. You never have to worry about your rent with Section 8 because the government is going to do it. The last thing I want to say on this is Even if you're saying, well, the city of Houston financially is in ruins, I'm not sure if they're going to be able to make it through, I want you to understand the voting base. Sylvester Turner, who's mayor of Houston, he's a black guy. A vast majority of his voters, like 35% of his voters, all came from Third Ward down to Sunnyside, down into South Union, which are the neighborhoods that I build in. There's fewer people in these neighborhoods, but they voted for him like 96% of the time. It's a predominantly black neighborhood, and it's where a majority, I think, of a lot of these Section 8 housing vouchers are coming from. This is his voting base. If the city of Houston goes bankrupt, they're not going to pay pensions. They're going to find programs to cut. They're going to do all kinds of things, but they're not going to cut this housing program. Because as soon as he cuts his housing program, I got to start evicting tenants who are his voting base, and now that impacts their life so dramatically that he will never get elected ever again. And if you look at the city of Detroit, the largest city in the United States to go bankrupt, they did not default on their housing program. And they didn't default because if you did, I can guarantee you that Sylvester Turner would not win re-election if he defaulted on this program. 100% guaranteed. So there's a political pressure here to keep this thing and to keep it growing because the waiting list is four times larger than the number of people even in the program. So there's an insane list because remember, income has not gone up and people are struggling because they can't build because the building and regulatory costs have gone up. So all this is to say that, there's a lot of things in the market that are going on and they're all trying to deal with these factors right here, and the government has largely just pushed interest rates down. And so what happens is when you go to get financing for my builds, it's incredibly difficult. And so you can't take advantage of this portion right here, which is dominating the economy, this interest rate ability. But here's the thing. If my cash on cash return is pretty darn good, and I think it's fantastic, then even if I was making, let's say I was making 16% ROI, and I'm just throwing out a number, if someone else is making 18%, what's happened to me consistently is an investor will come to me and say, well, Sean, it's obvious, I'm going to go for the 18%. What they didn't realize was that fundamentally, if interest rates go up, because I have an even lower than 80-20 loan to value, some of mine are only 75-25. And I'm at a 5.5 or 6% interest rate, whereas other people, they're down at 3% on this 90-10 deal and stuff. Fundamentally, if the interest rates move upward, which they have to, they can't go down any further. I just don't see it happening, and it's causing macro level effects in the economy that there's more effects than I can get into in this video. My returns might drop from 16% to 14%. Oh no, this dude's drops from 18% to 0% because of this 9-to-1 relationship that I have for a year. So if interest rates move 2%, you're still making great money on my deal, and this guy over here is bankrupt, and you've lost a significant amount of money that you put into his deals. He's upside down with it. And because the asset value for this dude over here is based on this return, remember, the entire asset value is based and predicated on this interest rate and this return. So this giant portfolio that you bought for $2 million and you think you're making tons of money might be worth 1.8 if the interest rate goes up. My asset, because it's not nearly as heavily predicated on the interest rate, that's not what the value comes from. The value, again, becomes I built a house that people need for less money than everyone else. That's the value. I didn't go find a deal. I built a deal. It's a product. It's something that people actually need. And so the interest rate doesn't affect me nearly as much. It just doesn't. Now, if I could find someone who's smart enough to get me to this 90-10 interest rate, this 16% would be a joke. It'd be like 46%. I don't know what it would be, but it would be so high. I could legitimately get a loan to build it for more money than it would cost me to build. And I'd be making money on the build and the refinance and the long-term hold as I'm making money as rents come in. But what I'm really trying to do more than anything is if I can get to 75-25 and I can convince people, hey, wait a second, this 75-25 is way safer than this 18%. So I'm going to get this 75-25. I'm going to make my, let's say it's even less than 16. Let's say it's 12%. Just take the solid interest rate knowing that if the economy goes belly up, and we can look at the Dow Jones Industrial Average, and you can look at it, and the average going, woo! At some point, it's going to correct itself and it's going to come back down to where it should be to create a line that's like 3% growth. At some point, it's going to. We know that. It always has. It always will. This is the one piece of information that we have. When the economy goes down and you get to this point right here, I can guarantee you that my asset is not going to go down in value. It's just not, because it's based on this Section 8 rental program where I'm getting my money no matter what, and it's based on the fact that I'm getting paid by the local government. I am getting paid $1,350 per unit, which is like $2,700 a month. And it doesn't matter what happens in the economy. It doesn't matter if the city of Houston goes bankrupt. Nothing matters. I make this amount of money right here. I'm not tied into interest rates. I like doing cash on cash investments. I like just building with cash and then refinancing it at an incredibly stable rate. Incredibly stable. After the refinance, I'm guessing that my mortgage taxes insurance will be between $1,500 and $1,700 per month, even if the interest rate skyrockets. And at this rate, I'm making $2,700 a month. You do the math. I've got $1,000 per month that I'm making on this investment, and I pulled out a majority of my money. I can pay off every dollar that you have in the deal within maybe 2 years, three at tops. So it's a phenomenal, phenomenal investment, and it's based on this market at large. And I'm going to zoom out so you can see everywhere that we went to. The interest rate is driving the increase in prices all throughout construction, matched with the regulatory costs, which are increasing the cost to build. Now, I'm just going to throw in some conjecture here at the end, but eventually this is going to pop. And it's going to pop in so many ways, because people legitimately, in this section right here, they can't afford the increased costs. They're just adding debt onto our society. So they're adding debt, and so to deal with that, we reduce the cost of debt by messing with the interest rate. But you know what? The regulatory costs here, they're still going up. And so eventually, because this is still going up, we're going to get to a point where you just can't drop the interest rate any lower. It's not going to go negative. It's just not. And so we're going to get to the point where we literally, as a society, cannot build affordable housing anymore because the regulatory costs are too high. And I can talk about the trade labor costs. I mean, that's going up as well. There's a lot of different macro factors. Building materials costs are going up. Not for me, remember, because I got the containers. But all these things are pushing this economy to a brink. And you should be worried. I'm incredibly concerned. My wife and I are considering moving out of the cities, getting away from all this nonsense, living mostly off of cash, and then just, you know, doing our own thing, because this is a huge, huge concern for us. So if you've made it this far in the video, hopefully you're sitting back and you're going, oh my goodness, this is a great cash flowing asset. It serves a need. It's literally bulletproof. And I make that as a joke, but it will stop a 9mm point blank. My house will. This is a solid investment. And if you're willing to make some money with me, let's build it. I'm more than ready for you. And I'm excited. Give me a call. Thanks for watching.